The Canucks chartered back to Vancouver immediately after Game 2. The Rangers flew out the next day, and because of the home ice advantage, this was only their second time in an airplane in more than 2 months. It remained to be seen whether the Rangers' lack of frequent flyer miles would work to their advantage. The trip to Vancouver meant a trip back home for Ranger forward Glenn Anderson and defenseman Doug Lidster. Both scored goals in Game 2. Lidster played with the Canucks for 10 years before being dealt to the Rangers during the offseason, while Anderson grew up just 6 blocks from Pacific Coliseum and was very happy to be back playing in front of his friends and family.
I could have gone complete reversal and ended up working on Dad's fish boat. But after being sick for 4 days straight the first time I was out, I definitely didn't want to make that my career.
And we're his number one fans.
Right.
We're coming here and watching the Orlando Curtain Backs, Andre Boudrias, Bobby Schmatz, Cesar Maniegos, Dennis Kearns, all the old guys back in the 70s, and coming here and now playing against the Canucks who have changed their uniforms around since I watched. It's pretty special coming into this building.
That's it, Jeff.
Both teams conducted short workouts on the off day at the Coliseum. First the Canucks, then the Rangers. Vancouver coach Pat Quinn was still upset that the Rangers were able to follow through on their Game 2 promise to create more traffic and more scoring chances in front of goaltender Kirk McLean.
New York even said they didn't say they're going to run our goaltender, they're going to be in traffic. Well, Graves was running our goaltender. And it wasn't stopped. There wasn't even a warning.
I don't think that there's any more contact with McLean, any more contact with McLean as opposed to contact with Richter.
The beautiful landscape of Vancouver, British Columbia. This, the spectacular Capilano Suspension Bridge, the longest of its kind. It's evident that support for the Canucks has been unwavering since their playoff run began. The city caught up in Canucks fever. Everywhere you turn, it's go Canucks go, even at the site of the new home arena under construction. Vancouver is home to Stanley Park, named by Lord Stanley himself. Downtown, the cup bearing his name was on prominent display for all Vancouverites to appreciate. Like their counterparts in New York, Canuck fans were in a feisty yet festive mood before Game 3. Inside, Canucks defenseman Brian Glynn limbering up and perhaps wondering what's in store for Game 3. Out of the Rangers' shadow stepped the Russian rocket, Pavel Bure.
Shot it to the line and out the center. Scored a goal on a breakaway. His second shift, he drew a penalty. What a start for him.
You're looking at a 5'10", 187-pounder going against 6'5", 225-pound Jeff Bukovum. And when Bure was trying to get the puck in front, it was a dead heat, folks.
The Rangers withstood Bure's early pressure and then tied the game on a fluke play.
Angelina couldn't get it out. Leach sends it in again, and it's in!
You're trying to survive there, and to get a break like that and all of a sudden you're tied up, it probably deflated them more than it helped us.
And if that doesn't go in, maybe the whole scenario doesn't happen. I mean, there's always ifs, ands, or buts, but you'd like to have that one back.
Then late first period, Bure and Jay Wells along the boards. Bure's high stick cut Wells on the nose.
I think he gets a 5-minute plus a game misconduct here, because Jay Wells was cut.
Bure, a 5-minute major for high sticking and a game misconduct.
Contrary to this batter, it was the Canucks up a creek without Pavel. 1 minute after his ejection.
And Chinoff down the slot, score! On a deflection by Glenn Anderson!
Chinoff made a great move on the blue line and fought off two of the Canucks, and I just went to the net, and Sergei shot the puck, and I deflected it, and it was fortunate enough that it held up to be the game-winning goal.
Late second period, Leach scored again, rebounding the shot by Esa-Tikkanen. Rangers take a 3-1 lead on Leach's ninth goal of the playoffs. Then just 25 seconds into the third, another lucky bounce for New York.
Larmer, all alone, deflected, score! A second fluke goal! This one shot in by Larmer, it wasn't on net, and it ends up at the back of the twine.
Nothing going right for Vancouver in Game 3, with the exception of keeping Mark Messier off the score sheet. Sean Antoski with the facial, but Game 3 belonged to the Rangers.
And the Rangers leading 4-1. Here's a chance for Kovalov. He scores! Alexei Kovalov! And the Rangers have two down and two to go in the Stanley Cup.
We did get a couple of lucky breaks tonight. But I think, you know, when you're working hard, you're going to make those breaks happen. And, you know, that's one thing I think that this team does well is we work hard, and we played hard for 60 minutes tonight.
Pavel's penalty, taking him out of the game, took the fans out of the game. And then that second basically lucky goal that we got really took the wind out of their sails.
I tried to hit him with my shoulder, and I think my stick just slid on his shoulder and hit him in the face. Lots of guys told me I should get, you know, two or four minutes, but not kicked out from the game.
I mean, in the eye, above the eye or whatever, and you know, it's, you know, sitting from the bench, they can't tell anyways. You know, it was, you know, right along the side of the board, so they couldn't see it or whatever, but I don't know if you call four stitches and a broken nose hurt or not. I don't know.
But was it a high sticking? Sure, but we have that 4 minute penalty. We have 2-4 and the five, and he elected to take the five. Unfortunate call for us, no question.
We certainly feel we can play with this team, beat them, and you know, the 5-1 loss, it's kind of lopsided on the scoreboard, but we didn't think it was that drastic of a difference between the two teams tonight.
We got to change this series into the best of nine. This is so good. What a war.